ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायण नमस्कृत्यं नारं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो चयं मुदीरयेत् नस्तापृषु अपात्रेषु नित्यं भगवत सेवया भगवति उत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिके इदं भगवतां नाम पुराणं ब्रह्मसंहितं उत्तमश्लोकचरितं चकार भगवान् ऋषि निःश्रेयसाय लोकस्य धान्यं स्वास्थ्य नमः कृष्णे स्वात्मपाकते धर्मज्ञानिभिः सह खलौ नास्तति शमेषा पुरुणार्कुतुनोतितः मुखं करोति वाचलं पङ्कुं लङ्घायति करीं यत्कृपतां वहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुं दीनतारणम् परमानन्द माधवं कृष्णचैतन्येश्वरं जय श्रीकृष्णचैतन्यप्रभुनित्यानन्द श्रीयाद्वैतगदाधर श्रीवासदि गौरभक्तवृन्द हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। ग्रंथराज श्रीमद्भागवतम् की जय। Read from Srimad Bhagavatam, 6th canto, 9th chapter, text 28. There's no purport. And 29 and 30. So we read verse number 30 here. Trishtvatam avanau sarva. Trishtvatam avanau sarva. Ikshanalata viklavaha Dandavat patitarachan Chanair uthaya tushtu Trishtvatam avanau sarva Ikshanalata viklavaha Dandavat patitarachan Chanair uthaya tushtavaha. Nishtvatam avanam sarvam. Vishvatam avanau sarva Ikshanalada viklava Dandava patitarachan Atma tulyai sutashabir Vina shivatsa kaustupau Paryupasitam Unnidra sharat sambura lekshanam Trishtvatam avanau sarva Ikshanalata viklavaha Dandavat patitarachan Chanair uthaya tushtu Atmatulyai Almost equal to himself. Sutashabhi by sixteen servants. Vina without Srivatsa Kaustubhav, the Srivatsa mark and Kaustubha jewel. Parya Upsitam, being attended being attended on all sides. Unnidra blooming. Sharad of the autumn. Amburu like the lotus flowers. Ikshanam having eyes. Trishtva seeing. Tam him, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayana. Avanau, on the ground, Sarve, all of them, Ikshana, from directly seeing, Alada, with happiness, Viklava, being overwhelmed, Dandavat, like a stick, Patitaha, fell, Rajan, O King, Shanai, slowly, Uthaya, standing up, Tushtuvu, offer prayers. Also read the previous verse. Sishu Kavacha, Ititesham Maharaja, Suranam Upatishtatam, Pratichyam Tishyabut Avi, Shankha Chakra Gadadhara. Sri Shukadev Goswami said, my dear King, when all the demigods offered him their prayers, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Hari, carrying his weapons, the conchal, disc, and club, appeared first within their hearts and then before them. Surrounding and serving the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayana, were 16 personal attendants, decorated with ornaments and appearing exactly like him, but without the mark of Srivatsa and the Kaustubha jewel. O King, when all the demigods saw the Supreme Lord in that posture, smiling with eyes like the petals of lotuses grown in autumn, they were overwhelmed with happiness and immediately fell down like rods, offering dandavats. Then they slowly rose and pleased the Lord by offering him prayers. Purport. In Vaikuntha Loka, the Supreme Personality of Godhead has four hands and decorations like the Srivatsa mark on his chest and the gem known as Kaustubha. These are special indications of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The Lord's personal attendants and other devotees in Vaikuntha have the same features except for the Srivatsa mark and the Kaustubha gem. Omakyati maranyasyankanamchana salakayam chakshurun militam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha. So here is, these chapters describe the appearance of the demon Vritrasura. Srimad Bhagavatam is famous because of this story of Vritrasura. And everyone who hears this story, and also other stories, of course, narrated in this great Purana, the Amala Purana, spotless Purana, they're very blessed. There's so much auspiciousness in hearing of about Srimad Bhagavatam, because Srimad Bhagavatam is full of wonderful stories, amazing stories, not stories, fiction, as we know in material world, on the earth, we have so many fiction books. Every year so many new fiction books coming out. But they come and go, but the Bhagavad Purana, like all the Puranas, they remain. And of all the Puranas, the Bhagavad Purana, the Srimad Bhagavatam, is considered the greatest of all the Puranas, the king, Grantharaj, the king of the Granthas, of the books, is the Srimad Bhagavatam. So wherever there is the king or emperor, all other Puranas are actually nearby and they're glorifying the greatness of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So Bhagavatam is known all over the universe, not only on the planet Earth. On the planet Earth, the Bhagavatam has 18,000 slokas, and in the heavenly planets, it has millions. Never mind if it has originally four slokas or 18,000 or millions, the principle of Srimad Bhagavatam has to be clear in the heart, established in the heart of the devotee. If you understand the principle of Bhagavatam, then everything of Bhagavatam becomes clear, like the sunshine. When everything is in darkness, then nothing is clear. We're all ghosting or moving around in an insecure situation. So the material world is like a darkness. So without the sun, we have no vision, we have no eyes. Even if we have eyes, we have senses, but they're useless without the appearance of the sun. So we have the worldly sun, Surya, who is a demigod, who is a planet also, who has his planet, Surya Loka, who is very effulgent. He's very powerful now. But there's a more powerful sun, and this sun is the sun of Srimad Bhagavatam. The sun of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Krishna svatama bhagate, dharma jnani bisaha, kalaunastvatishammesha, purunarkodunoditaha. So this sun, the Srimad Bhagavatam, is so brilliant that dissipates all the darkness of ignorance, especially in the Kali Yuga. Everyone is in ignorance. And the Bhagavatam appeared in this Kali Yuga especially to shed everyone the light, giving them the direction where to go. And in the Bhagavatam, Dharma, Vairagya, this all attains as a byproduct. The main principle of Bhagavatam is bhakti. It's devotion, it's love to Krishna. That's the spiritual world. In the spiritual world, everyone is in full love, and harmony with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. There's no envy. Because in the spiritual world, there's no ahankara, there's no false ego. The material principle, the principle of material world is ahankara. Ahankara is the beginning of the creation. And it penetrates the whole universe down to the bottom of the universe, Patala Loka, up to Brahma Loka. Everyone is under the impression of ahankara. What means ahankara? Ahankara means false designation, false identification. Upadis. So we have so many upadis. I'm a demigod. I'm a human. I'm a demon. I'm a beautiful person. I'm a very rich person. I'm a very powerful person. I'm a very influential and famous person. Oh, I'm a very renowned person. I perform so much tapasya, so much vairagya. And I'm a very learned person. I'm very scholarly. But these are all false designations. Without the mercy of the Lord, we cannot achieve Him. Because in the Lord, these six opulences are fully there. Satyashvarya Purnam. All six opulences, what we have mentioned now, are in Bhagavan. Therefore, He's known as Bhagavan. All auspiciousness, all bhaga, is attained in the Supreme Lord. And the compiler of Vishnu Purana, the speaker of Vishnu Purana, Parashara Muni, he defined what is Bhagavan. Aishvaryasya, Samagrasya, Viryasya, Yasasa Shriya, Jnana Vairagya Shaiva, Shat Bhaga Itingana. So these six opulences are fully manifested eternally in the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He's full there. And also in his associates, eternal associates in the spiritual world, they have the similar qualifications of qualities as the Supreme Lord. They have the beauty, they dress like him, they look similar like him, they have also lotus eyes, lotus face. They have so many wonderful qualities similar to him. They have similar ornaments like the Lord. Only the difference is that the Lord, as we hear here, he has a Srivatsa sign on the right side of his chest. It's a whirl of hair locks, of shiny hair locks. Gold, sometimes described golden or yellowish or white, who are turned left side. The world goes on left side. It represents Lakshmi Devi. Lakshmi Devi resides always on the chest of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So on the right side, of the right side of his chest, he has a very bluish, dark bluish body, and the right side, the mark of Srivatsa, is a sign, a special sign. Here, your face, you have the darshan of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And the Kaushtubha, Srivatsa, what is it called? Kaushtubha Mani, the jewel of Kaushtubha. It's a very valuable, crest jewel of all the jewels. So these two ornaments are the decorations on the Lord's chest. When Gop Kumar, for example, came to Vaikuntha, he entered to all the different gates, and he saw all different similar persons like Vishnu, Lord Vishnu. He wanted to get the darshan of Lord Vishnu, Jagadishvara, the Lord of the universe, for whom he was so much anxious to get the darshan. He traveled for that all over the universe to achieve that. And wherever he came, in every planet, he got the darshan of a partial incarnation of the Lord. And wherever he came, he thought, this is the perfection. So he came on the way to Goloka, to Vaikuntha. And when he entered to the different gates, he saw so many, one after another, personalities who had similar appearance like the Lord. They had bluish color, yellow dress, lotus eyes, nice decorations, beautifully looking, so very powerful, effulgent personalities. And whoever he saw or he met on the way, he offered his dandavat. Om Namo Narayana Namaha. So he immediately want to offer obeisance to Lord Narayana. But the devotee closes his eyes because I'm not Narayana. Narayana is in the inner chambers of the palace. You have to go through the seventh gate. And then you will meet him. You will get the darshan. So he could at that point not distinguish between associates of the Lord and the Lord himself. Like he didn't know the distinguished mark of Srivatsa and Kaushtubha Mani. So that again offered again and again and again, and all the time he thought, this must be the Lord of my heart, Narayana. But always he met the devotees, and the devotees thought, go further. And by the blessings of the devotees, he ultimately got the darshan of Lord Narayana. But Gop Kumar, because he was a Gopa from Vrindavan, so he had the Gopa Vesha, he had the dress of Gopa. So when the devotees in Vaikuntha, they thought, you know, you cannot come with this Vanara dress,
dress of a cowherd or a forest dweller. You cannot enter Vaikuntha like that. You have to dress like us, like the Vaikuntha Vasis, to appear like that, because we have a certain etiquette here, we have a certain dress here, a certain culture, certain attitude, seva, everything is described. It's vidhi, it's a vaidhi mark. It's very prescribed in the last detail how you have to behave. Like if you take darshan in the Queen Elizabeth in London, you know, then you have to dress yourself accordingly. You have to have a certain portfolio to follow, etiquette, everything you have to know. Cannot just spontaneously go as you are, here I am, Queen Elizabeth, I want to come and congratulate you for your 90th birthday. It's not possible. They don't let you in. For the congratulation of 90th birthday, they will not let you in. So Gop Kumari was spontaneous. He was spontaneous. He was a cowherd boy from Vrindavan. And he was not ready to change his dress. He thought, how can I change my dress? I am as I am. I cannot, if the Lord is not accepting me like that, what can I do? So when he got the darshan of the Lord was very happy, and he even congratulated him that you came, and thanked him that you finally come here. I had a desire so much that you come. Although according to the law of nature, you had to stay longer time in the material world. But then I made different arrangements ultimately that you could come to me. So that's the Lord's special mercy. And then something very wonderful happened. Lord Narayana himself, he became a cowherd boy. He started to play the flute, and he became very happy when he saw Gop Kumar as a cowherd boy from Vrindavan. Immediately he became reminded about Vrindavan, because Lord Narayana understands his position. I'm the Supreme Personality of Godhead, or the source of me. I'm the Lord, but the source of me is Krishna. I'm the Lord of Vaikuntha, Vaikunthanath. And all my associates, they're serving me here in 2.5 rasas. In Vaikuntha, there are 2.5 rasas. And Dasya Ras is predominant Shantaras, Dasya Ras, and Sakya Ras. But Sakya Ras in the mood of Pandava Arjuna. Pandava Arjuna, he's in Aishwarya Sakiras. I mean, sometimes he sees Krishna in two-arm form and sometimes in four-arm form. Sometimes he's very much impressed by his opulences, but at the same time he's also a very intimate friend. But in Dwaraka mood, that means in Mathura and in Hastinapur mood. Hastinapur, Mathura, and Dwaraka is the same. This is Aishwarya. That means the Supreme Lord is the king. Someone needs a certain attitude, etiquette to serve him. And the service there is according to strict rules and regulations prescribed. In Goloka, this is more in the spontaneous mood, because the principle there is love. The principle of Vaikuntha is also love. It is prema. Prema without envy, without impurities. Sarvapati vinir muktam tapparatvena nirmalam rishikena rishikesha sevanam bhakti ruchate. So bhakti is free of the false upadis. I'm a king, I'm a demigod, I'm beautiful man, I'm beautiful woman, I'm very famous, I'm very rich. This is material upadis or designations. So Narad Muni in Narada Pancharatra, he says one has to give it up. Only if one is free of these upadis and one tapparatvena nirmalam, if one's heart becomes Vishuddha Sattva, that means the spiritual world and the service to the Lord in the spiritual world is Vishuddha Sattvam. Sattvam Vishuddham Vasudeva Shaptitam. Because only on the Vasudeva Sattva in the Shuddha Sattva platform, Vishuddha, that means no material goodness is even there. But to speak of passion and ignorance is all absent. So in that pure goodness, the Lord is revealed. So now one may be questioned, how is it possible that the Lord could manifest in front of demigods who are not in the mode of goodness all the time? They're in the mode of goodness, material mode of goodness, but not transcendental. How is it possible that the demigods could get the darshan of Lord Vishnu? Again, principle of Bhagavatam is, we have to understand, the Lord is bound by the prema, by the love and the affection of the devotee. And he has out of this love and affection, he has one very wonderful quality, and this is called karuna. Karuna, that means mercy, kindness. And the law, and another principle is humility. Although the Lord is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, He's the only one who has no false ego. This was proved by Bhrigu Muni. We know the story from Bhagavatam in the end of 10th canto. Bhrigu Muni was sent by the sages because they wanted to find out who is Ishvara, who is Parameshvara. Is it Shiva? Is it Brahmaji? Or is it Lord Vishnu? Because these are the three famous principal deities in this universe, you know. So, and there are different kinds of devotees. Some say Shivaji is the Supreme Lord. Some say Brahma is the Supreme. Mostly they say Vishnu is the Supreme. So, but the sages, they wanted to find out themselves. They wanted to have the vigyan, not only the gyan from the books, from the knowledge, from the scripture. They wanted to test it, to testify it. So they sent Bhrigu Muni, a great sage, Brahmin, first class Brahmana. So they sent him, because he's coming from Brahma line, son of Brahma. So he went to Brahma, and instead of offer Brahma respect, as one should do to a Guru Varg, to his father, to somebody who is senior, one should offer respect, dandava pranam, and at least respectfully greet him, and with a service attitude, with a thankfulness and appreciation for that what the great personality, the father or great personality of your forefathers did. So he neglected that etiquette because he consciously, purposefully, because he wanted to make Brahma upset. He wanted to test Brahma if he will become angry. And it really, indeed, it happened. Brahma got angry. He got upset. So he almost wanted to punish and smash his son Bhrigu. But then Bhrigu realized Brahma cannot be the Supreme Lord because anger became manifested, became upset, although he could control himself. He could control himself. Then he went to Shiva, to his brother. And Shiva, he was very happy. Oh, Bhrigu, my brother, Baya, you're here. Nice to see you. For so long time I didn't saw you. He came, raised himself, and wanted to embrace him. But Bhrigu said, don't touch me. Don't touch me, you muchi fellow. I'm Brahmin. I come from pure Brahmana line. Although you're my brother, but don't you not touch me because you're impure. Look how you're dressed. Skulls. What kind of ointment you have on your skin? Ashes of the dead. You look like a ghostly person. I don't want to that you're touching me. Otherwise, where I will take a bath? Shiva became very, very upset. Can I imagine, you know? Rudra became manifest. And he practically wanted to burn Bhrigu to ashes. So Bhrigu also understand, oh, my brother Shiva, you cannot be the Supreme Personality of God. Of course, he had this in mind. He didn't spoke it out. He had this in mind, he understood, he offered his respect, ultimately pacified Shiva and went on. So he came to Vaikuntha, Vishnu Loka. Lord Vishnu is Kshiradakasha here in this, the principal deity of the material universe is Kshiradakashai Vishnu. He's lying on the gigantic snake, Sahasra, Shirsha. Ananta Shesha, on the milk ocean, Kshira ocean, milk ocean. He's always in a very relaxed, always happy mood, because he's Ananda Maya Purusha. Ananda Maya Purusha means he's always full of ananda, always full of happiness, of joy. And all his associates around him, like the 16 shaktis, and the 16 associates, the 16 servants, headed by Nanda and Sunanda, and the 16 energies, Shri, Bhu, Leela, in Bengal, Neela, and so on, Icha, Shaktis, all these 16 Shaktis, they're always ready to serve the Lord on his side, to give him pleasure, to give him pleasure. Although he's already full of pleasure. But still, there are so much great devotees, they understand our pleasure is the Lord's pleasure. So if the Lord is happy, to our service, to our existence, to our beauty, by our kind of dress, by our kind of seva, by our kind of behavior or performance, then if the Lord is happy, we are happy. We are not happy because I'm just a nice singer, a nice musician, a nice speaker, a nice dancer, a nice manager. A nice, learned, educated person. I know how to dress myself. I know how to behave myself. This alone doesn't give us happiness without that the Lord is happy. Tasmin tushta, jagat tushta. If the Lord is happy, then we become happy. And everything around you also becomes happy. Therefore, he is Ananda Maya Purusha. He's always full of ananda. He's never miserable. So Bhrigu Muni, he wanted to test Lord Vishnu. Will he become miserable? Will he become angry? And he wanted to make the greatest of offense. First, verbally offended, disobeyed, or disrespected Brahma. Actually, not verbally, mentally. Then verbally, Shiva. But now, physically, he wanted to offend Lord Vishnu. How to do that? So he came there and he put his foot on the chest of Lord Vishnu. If you're a great person, a king, or whether even an ordinary person, somebody will come to your home and puts his foot on your chest when you're sleeping there. How he would react? Immediately will become upset, will become angry, and would smash the person. What you are doing? But Vishnu was not like that. He felt blessed. He felt happy, more happiness even. His happiness is increased. Why? Because I'm so much honored, he said, because the footprint of a pure Brahmana is now on my chest, the resting place of Lakshmi Devi, of Sri Vatsa. That's a resting place. Even Sri herself is not directly taking shelter on the Lord's chest, only in the form of this hair lock. Where is her sitting place? On the lotus feet of the Lord, always massaging, always making comfort in Dasya Ras, serving the Supreme Lord, try to please Him. And she never leaves this service. Lakshmi, she can go to many other places, but she's Chanchala. She never stays for a long time in one place. But in Lord Vishnu's lotus feet, she always stays. That's her eternal place. Srinivasa. Srinivas. Therefore, the resting place or the place where Sri, the home of Sri, is the lotus feet of Lord Vishnu. There she always resides. There she is happy. So even these great personalities, they are always happy because they can serve the Lord. And Bhrigu Muni, and even the Lord, when he became offended, gravely offended, severely offended, physically, by touch of the feet of this Brahmana. The Brahmana, he's not transcendental necessarily. He doesn't have to be a devotee. He still considers himself, even if he's a great devotee, he doesn't, especially in Vaikuntha, he cannot put, it's against the etiquette, against the portfolio to put your feet, even you're a Brahmana, to put your feet on the Lord's chest. It's a big offense. But the Lord is so merciful, he's so kind to his devotees, to the Brahmanas, Brahmana Hitayacha. Because he's the well-wisher of the Brahmanas, the protector of the Brahmanas. He's always kind to the Brahmanas, to the cows and the Brahminical culture. So that's his nature. So he felt very honored, very blessed. And since that time, he even carried another mark on his chest, besides the Sri Vatsa, the Bhrigu mark, the Bhrigu pad. The footprint of Bhrigu he carried on his chest, Lord Vishnu. That's another mark nobody else has, because only Bhrigu's foot was on the chest of the Lord. And the Lord is carrying it as a decoration. And he told to Bhrigu Muni, he addressed Bhrigu Muni, "Oh, how honored I am, how fortunate, how auspicious my day is starting today, because the pure Brahmana, Bhrigu, my devotee, is putting his chest, his food on my chest. So I'm so much blessed." Of course, Lakshmiji, she didn't took it so nicely. The Lord did, he was never angry, but Lakshmiji got upset on the Brahmana, Bhrigu. And therefore, it is said, since that time, mostly, the Brahmanas, they're not very rich. They don't have the blessings of Lakshmi Devi, of the goddess of fortune. Because Lakshmi in the material world, the goddess of fortune, material world is an expansion of Raja Lakshmi. Dayam sada paribhavagyam abhishtadoham tirtaspadam shivarinchinutam charanyam pritartiham pranapala pavapti potam vande mahapurushate charanaravindam. In the Bhagavatam, 11th canto, it is stated that the devotee always let us meditate about the Mahapurusha, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is Anandamaya Purusha, always full of happiness and bliss. Eternally, let us meditate about him, because even the great devotees, personalities, Ishvaras like Brahma, Shiva, Virinchinutam, they always pray to his lotus feet, and ask for benedictions for their service. So to that Purusha, Mahapurusha, let us offer our obeisances. And what this Purusha did, Yaktvasa Dushicha Sarepsita Racha Lakshmim, Dharmishta Aryavacha Satyatagat Aranyam, Mayam Rigam Daiti Epsitam Anvadavat, Vandema Purusha Te Charanaravindam. Again, I offer my obeisances this to the lotus feet of this Mahapurusha, who once gave up his house, beautiful house, and Lakshmi Devi, due to a curse of a Brahmana. He left the home and the association of Lakshmi Devi, and he went to the forest to hunt after the Maya Mriga, hunting after the conditioned souls, helping them to find the way to his lotus feet. So to that Lord, we offer our obeisances. So Rajya Lakshmi always stays on the Lord's feet, although the Lord is not so much attached to her at all. He's not so much attached, because he's more attached to his unalloyed devotees. And for them, he's giving his own self. He's ready to give his own self to his unalloyed devotees, because they give everything to him. Their body, mind, words, life, possessions, everything. They have no upadis, they have no false designations. They're free of false ego. They're similar in nature like the Lord. They're full of love to him. They're full of mercy to all living entities. And they're always humble and meek. This is the quality of the devotees. And these are the qualities what the Lord attracts to a devotee. So, and this is the main principle of the Bhagavatam, this prema, karuna, and humility, meek and humbleness. These qualities we have to cultivate. Actually, we cannot be cultivated. It's the nature of the soul by nature, by the Svarup. But due to contact with the material nature, whose main principle is ahankara, that means no mercy, no love, only lust, greed and anger, and no humility, but proudness, to be puffed up, arrogance. This is the materialistic nature. And everyone is influenced by this materialistic nature as long we are in contact with it. The principle is there. The principle of material nature is false ego and all the byproducts of it. No mercy means only enjoyment. Even if you have more money, so much, you don't give it for the welfare of others. Only also, again, for increasement of your false ego, you give. But this is not devotion, and we should not be propagated. And should not propagate how much donation I give to the deities or to the Lord, or for spreading the Sankirtan movement. Because a devotee always gives his results to Krishna. To the Lord. He knows, because it's only by the mercy of the Lord that I have it, that I became instrumental. It is not my glory. I'm not the speaker, I'm not the singer, I'm not the donator, I'm not the manager, I'm not the ruler here. This is all done by Krishna's mercy, by the Lord's mercy. And this we should this devotee always remembers, and he should never forget. Because as soon as we forget, then we commit offense, like Indra. And I'm Indradev, I'm the Purandar, I'm the king of the heavenly planets. And then when his guru came, he didn't greet him properly. He didn't rise from his throne, from his seat. He didn't offer pranam, obeisances. And therefore he lost all his power, because Guru hided himself. Guru didn't give him mercy in that time, and Indra had to hide. Then he committed another offense. He killed one Brahmana, Vishwarup, three-headed Brahmana. He killed him because of a slight offense, tendency what this Brahmana had. So again, he got a curse because of that. He got an offense because of that offense. Then he had to hide himself. He became powerless. And the demigods became very desperate. And therefore, they had to go. When they're desperate, then they suddenly remember Vishnu. They remember Vishnu always, because they're offering oblations in all the different planets, even Brahmaloka also offering oblations to the Yagyas for the pleasure of the Lord, because they understand without His mercy we cannot maintain our position or our duty. So, but then sometimes they forget because they're so much active in the mode of passion and duties of heavenly planets, of a demigod. But then they remember, because therefore they are devotees. Vishnu Bhakta Smito Daiva, the demigods are devotees by nature. They are devotees, therefore they got this position. Then they remember Krishna, the Vishnu, and then they approach, they meditate about him, offering prayers to him. And because the Lord is kind to the devotees, to the demigods, because the demigods are his part and parcels. The expansion of Jayadakshaya Vishnu is the universal form, Virat Purusha. And the demigods are all his part and parcels of this Virat Purusha. So when the Lord sees that his devotees, his expansions, the demigods are in trouble, and then they're calling out to him, they're meditating about him, they're offering prayers to him, then he manifests himself from within their heart, because he's situated in everyone's heart, so he manifests himself externally. So he appears internally and externally to help for the interests of the demigods. Although the Lord is impartial, he's not for the demigods, not against the demons, because he's neutral. He's only partial to his devotee, who is fully given, surrendered in love and devotion to the Lord, to him, to such devotee. Krishna, the Lord, is fully surrendered, or gives his heart, his life. It's even more dear than his own life. So, but in the material world, he's not partial to anyone, and he doesn't therefore take any side. But the demons, they never approach the Lord. They're always viparya, they're always in opposition. Therefore, the demigods, they're devotees, although not pure, they're mixed devotees. But the Lord is appearing for their interest, because he's the maintainer of the universe. The demigods are creators, they're managers in this universe. Lord Rudra is the destroyer, but Lord Vishnu is the maintainer. Ultimately, only he can maintain, he can protect. Nobody else can protect without that the Lord ultimately protects. So he's, and that the demigods, they know. Some demons, if they're lucky or fortunate, like Bali Maharaj, then they also check it and they become surrendered to Lord Vishnu's lotus feet. And then they get blessings. Become devotee. But the demigods, they are surrendered to Vishnu, they pray to him, and therefore the Lord appears. But he doesn't go, he didn't went in action in that case. He understood it was Indra's mistake. And it's in general the material nature. It is not the Lord who is causing us to act in a sinful or in an offensive way. It is our false ego, our false upadis, and our impure mind. And as long as they are not fully dedicated and engaged in the service of Krishna, they cannot become purified. So the Lord, he therefore agreed, I will help you, Indra, for your interest, that you get back your power, that the demigods, the demons will not conquer you. And he gave him a lesson. You go to Dadichi Muni, because Dadichi is a very powerful devotee, great sage, and he has no more upadhi. He doesn't think, I'm the body, I'm this, I'm a sage, I'm a great powerful personality. He was not attached to his body anymore. You go to him and ask him for his bones. Oh, bones. You should ask bone from a sage. Aye, aye, what is that? But Vishnu say, yes, you should ask for his bone. Because in his bone there's so much tejas, so much powers. And with these tejas you can kill Vritrasura. You make a thunderbolt weapon out of it. So Indra went and asked for Dadichi Muni, pleased him, offered respect to him, and asked him, can we have your bones? Dear sir, dear sage, who is ready to give your own bones? Huh? But Dadichi Muni immediately agreed. Why not? For a higher mission, for a higher purpose, I'm ready to give everything for myself. My whole body, everything that I possess, I will give. Why not some bones? You can immediately have them for a higher purpose. For the interest of the Supreme Lord, if he sent you to me to ask for my bones, I will give them gladly. So he gave up his life and happily went back home, back to Godhead. And Indra, he got the bones. He was also happy. And he got the thunderbolt weapon. Was very powerful. And with this thunderbolt weapon, he could kill ultimately Vritrasura, although also with great difficulty. So anyway, Bhagavatam is full of this kind of stories and also with nice lessons in it. And this is most important. The story is not so much important. The story is detail. The message, the point in the story, it's important. And that I more or less explained. But the time factor, I'm stopping here. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Glory to Prabhupada, Grantaraj, Srimad Bhagavatam, Ki Jaya. Maybe one question, or Maharaj, have a comment? Maybe, or maybe I forgot something, another point from this sloka.
In towards the end of this chapter, in the Bhagavad Gita, there is a very interesting story. Like you are mentioning that Lord told Indra that they go and beg bones from the deity. In that Bhagavad Gita, that story for Bhagavad Gita, very much, perhaps Indra was not interested to go to the deity. Because the deity and Indra has very strong enmity for something. One time one person, that Ashwini Kumara, physician of heaven, celestial planet, they were searching who is the most powerful, most pious, learned personality. And because they wanted to learn something of Adhyatma, the spiritual side. That time the Dadhiti was the most famous and most knowledgeable person. So they came to the Dadhiti and they requested, please enlighten us, empower us, transcendental knowledge. So they said, now I am busy, but after 3 weeks you come and I will instruct you and teach you. Indra came to know that my subordinate, physician, Why they should know the spiritual life? What made it? Immediately in that came to the Rishi and he told Indra, the Rishi, please, I have heard that, I know that you have given appointment, but going to teach me spiritual science, please don't do that. If you dare to instruct them, then I will chop off your head. By the mouth you are speaking, that mouth, the head will be beheaded from the ground. So please don't dare to instruct them in spiritual science. And when the appointment was there, Asmi Kumara came and they are very much surprised how come that previously when they came, the city was so jubilant, very, but now it was a little morose, not so much like. So they asked, but how come that when we came few days ago, we were so jubilant, everything was okay, now we spend it as something going on. Please tell us, we are heavenly physicians. We can cure any disease. If you are mentally or physically, please. Then the disease related to what happened. Because I have promised you, certainly I will give you some Indra knowledge, but I have to pay the price. Indra will chop off my head. And then I said, when I don't worry. Not in the, we are going to chop off your head, cut off your head. You will cut your head, you will join the horse head on your trunk, and you instruct when Indra will come, he will cut, maybe cut your head, and then we will replace the restore your heart. So this incident then happened when Indra came to know that he is a. I have given him threat, warning, still the deity instructing. Immediately Indra came, and for a long distance, he threw him weapon and head of the deity, which was a horse head, and Indra left. And then the original head was replaced. So this happened all, and this incident had happened. And Lord told Indra, go you, go, and beg force from. And you know, I can do that. I don't know how I will show my best. I have, for my part, I have killed him. So that, you know, you see that I am power of behavior of my devotee. Certainly he did. Still, but you know, I can't show my face in front of the disciples. I have so much of energy. Then they said, don't worry, if not you, you take Asmi Kumara, they should take. And that when they reached the ashram, then Indra never uttered, never opened the mouth. In his behalf, Asmi Kumara, disciples of the Rishi, they asked, and they okay, for higher power, for the welfare of the people in general, what is the price of this body? I am so fortunate today that my body is some use. So this Indra, I was telling that Indra was very much, he was not enthusiastic to go and make bones. He was not a good for them. And this is a story, I think, was similar to Rupa Dhajini that in the forefront. So to read this chapter.
Okay. Thank you. Hare Krishna. Mopati Prabhu, you want to say something? Add something?
From the prayers by the demigods, one thing we can understand that they felt some fearful situation because of the appearance of Uttasura. But immediately they started offering prayers to Lord Vishnu, to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And just by offering few prayers or few slogans, the Supreme Personality of God and appear before them and fulfill whatever they desire, remove their fear and give them benediction. So, out of the nine processes of devotional service, Vandana or offering prayers is one of them. And usually the hearing and chanting, the first two are said to be the most important, but equally offering prayers is also very, very important. Simply by offering prayers one can please the Lord, so much so that the Lord was obliged to appear personally and benedict them. So, Vandana is very, very important.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So we stop here. Hare Krishna. Lord Prabhupada.